I'll add a couple of things to what Steve said. In terms of when you're looking at a cigar, this is quality control. Some people say that quality control starts on a field somewhere. I disagree. Like Steve said earlier, I don't believe in a drug testing machine. I never have. I think drug testing machines, there was a time where people thought it was a deterrence, okay? And at the end of the day, I think that that deterrence is gone. There was people being scared of a drug testing machine. Oh, I'm going to make my cigars right because of that scary drug testing machine. I think that's a bunch of bullshit. And what I think is, when you look onto our factory floor and you see 82 blue shirts, that means there's 82 quality control supervisors who are out there, not super, but quality control people, who are blue shirt, blue smock. And what they're doing is they're walking around and they're making sure that the tobaccos that we're making every day are being checked every 15 minutes or every half an hour, depending on what's going on. And to give you some idea of why that's important, let me show you a little bit about, I think it's a fundamental philosophy about, and I want you to listen to this really carefully, all right? This is something that I think is one of the more important points of quality control, is this. When you have a Pochero and a Rolero who come to the window that I showed you earlier, the bodega windows, and they bring their little card, and we issue off on that little card, how many tobaccos they're going to be given? We know for that day, let's imagine we want that roller that day, just as an example, to make 300 cigars, okay? Certain cigars here at the factory make 350, certain 325, Liga's 200, Johnny makes 225, whatever. But overall, let's just imagine you have a Pochero and a Rolero who have to deliver you back as a pair 300 cigars. I'm not really worried about the wrapper because that's going to be evident what's going on with wrapper. With wrapper, we're looking for a certain amount. We're looking for, is the tobacco have manchar? Remember the underneath, the color coming through underneath? Is the cigar straight? Does it have a bow to it? Does the end trumpet out, or is it a straight Pareto's twist? On a lighter color wrapper, is the veins, you know, when we look at veins, we want to see thin veins, but guess what, on a Connecticut shade tobacco, you're going to be looking for tobaccos that have white veins, very ugly spider white veins, so the wrapper is going to speak to us very clearly, okay, but what we're looking for from a perspective of the blend, remember I said to you, we talk about making a blend year after year consistently, to make a blend year after year consistently, you have to make a blend day to day, month to month, week to week, always consistent. Let me give you an example of how you get burned on the production floor. What happens is, you come over and boil the chicken, come over, you guys are gonna make you 250, 300 cigars for the day. So we're gonna issue you out tobacco. Now let's imagine you've been issued out tobacco, and now here you are throughout your day, and you know you've been given just enough tobacco to make 300 cigars of that blend. So what are you gonna do? You're gonna go and make cigars either the way we want you to make them, or the way you want to make them. How can we make a cigar consistent year to year? If we can't make a cigar consistent, forget day to day, how about in one day? Just one day. So let's take 3 pounds of tobacco here. Let's imagine your Seikos, your Risos, or your Lejanos, just as an example, right? And here you are, Mr. Bonchero, and throughout the day, in the early part of the day, you're using a ton of Seiko. You're using way more Seiko than you should be using. You're going crazy on your Seiko, all right? And you used a little bit of your Viso, and you didn't even fucking touch your Lejero. So all throughout the day, what blend did you make? You made a nice big Seiko blend all day long with a little bit of Viso and no Lejero in it. But you know, hey, wait a second, I gotta use up, when I go to deliver the tobacco, I gotta bring my 300 cigars. Hey, boss, here's all the extra tobacco, look how much tobacco. I say, you can't do that. You gotta come back with no tobacco, none. We know exactly how much to weigh out. So what happens is, what do? Half the day they make this nice mild blend, and guess what they're doing the second half of the day? They're putting this shit in there and making another blend the second half of the day. So you didn't even get to get year-to-year consistency. You're not even able to get day-to-day consistency. So this is something that, when you talk about why cigars are a certain price that they are, cigars are the price that they are because the material that you use, the conditions of your employees, your skills on the production floor, and as well as how many people you have in middle management checking all day long that these piles are moving down evenly and the piles are moving down at the same pace. And they're eyeing it all day long to see what's going on. Why do you have so much Viso here? You should not have that much Viso here. What are you doing wrong? Take all the cigars, bring them back over here, we gotta smoke. And that's a very important thing. The second thing and my last thing that I'm gonna illustrate before Steve wraps up and we move on to packaging is this. The thing that we keep talking about at Drew Estate here on the tour is the draw. And when we talk about draw, I love it when I talk to somebody and they say to me, you know what? The cigar was plugged down here at the foot. Once I got past that, it really loosened up and it got better. This goes back for me to 2002. The draw on your cigar is never tight on the foot. The cigar is the draw on your tobacco. If you're taking a cigar and you're tubing a tobacco, okay, then you're tubing it, you're putting the tobacco into your left hand, okay? What's happening with leaf position in your hand is the tobacco in your hand is being controlled by your thumb. Everything's being controlled by your thumb. Let's imagine you take tobacco, you're tubing it. It doesn't matter if you're accordioning it, okay? If you're accordioning the tobacco, which is the tobacco way I like to do it, you're accordioning the tobacco. You're creating this sort of bunch in your left hand. That bunch, eventually that bunch is going to get broken down. And when that bunch gets broken down into your hand, it means they're going to take the tobacco and they're going to take this. And now remember, the thumb is controlling everything. And they're going to take this tobacco and put it into the bunch, okay? And in that bunch, what happens is your cigars, what is the most easy thing to do? The easiest thing to do when they break the bunch is stick it right under the thumb because they're holding it tight. And now they're ready to take their binder and their base and roll up their cigar. So what you have is always, cigars are always plugged under the band. Cigars are always plugged in the same place, not 99, 100 times out of 100 times. So that to me, once you're spending all of that time making sure that your tobaccos are being broken down correctly, they're being placed so that there's no soft spots in the tobacco, in the cigar, you might as well at that point be having to position your tobaccos that you've broken, all these tobaccos, a big part of your bunch, making sure those tobaccos are positioned in the correct way so that the draw is perfect and the blend is perfect. These guys who have little tricks, they want to get all the heaviest leaf tobacco, the points where all the flavor is, all in the front, so when you first light up the cigar, you get that big boom, you know what I'm saying? Sometimes, you ever notice some cigars you smoke, they're lighter when you start, they build up, other cigars are real strong, and then dwindle down. This is all about leaf positioning, and the master leaf positioner is able to determine what you want is, you want an experience from the cigar that delivers two things. You want complexity, and when I say complexity, what I'm saying is you're burning that cigar. Does the cigar just take you on a journey in terms of complexity? The way everybody in this room thinks about it is, does the cigar go somewhere, or is it a 6x60 that just is straightforward all the way through, the same flavor? That's what a 6x60 will give you. But other cigars should give you it went stronger, it got milder, different flavors came out. This is very different for me than when we talk about depth, the texture. When you smoke your cigar, at that one puff, at that one moment in time, is that cigar giving you layers of taste? Or is that cigar giving you a one-dimensional Indonesia, the tip of your tongue, metal can taste? That to me is a no-no. What you want is, you want depth in your tobacco. So if that all comes down to the tobaccos you use and the leaf positioning. So that's it.